And we are live.
Dr. Arika, is there any technical glitch from your side? Hello? No, are you speaking?
Ma'am, we are live.
Good evening. Welcome to lecture 26 of iFocus. Today we have Dr. Muralidhara from L.V. Prasad Institute, Hyderabad, who will be speaking to us on congenital and development corneal disorders. He has done his MS at Bangalore Medical College. He did clinical fellowships in cornea anterior segment at LVPI. Pediatric Ophthalmology Fellowship at Storm Eye Institute, South Carolina, USA. He has special interest in the field of congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophies and also won the Best Poster Award at AO 2014 for his work in CHED. We are very fortunate to hear this topic from you, sir. Welcome and over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Harika. Thanks for kind introduction. And I thank also Vanavar and so the entire team for giving me this opportunity. I'll be happy to share, you know, our work here. So we also have a new center called, you know, the Center for the Rare Eye Disease as well as the Systemic Diseases. Okay. So I'll be taking you to certain interesting surgical videos. I do not have any financial, you know, interest disclosure pertinent to this particular talk. So I'll be sharing as a case based. So with each case based, I would also highlighting how did I come to this particular diagnosis? What are the differential diagnoses and how do we go and manage these cases? Okay. So you are free to, you know, interrupt me, and I want to be as engaging, as interactive as possible rather than a, you know, extended monologue. So this was a 12-year-old boy who came to me about 10 years ago with a glare, particularly during the bright light. And he has a disability, particularly during the school hours. On examination, we saw this particular thing. Can any postgraduate take up what exactly you see, slit lamp images of the right and the left eye? What do you see? Are we connected?
Yes, sir.
One of you
can take the question.
There's a congenital cataractous lens with synecdoche.
Okay. Anything else? Any better guess? Do you want a more information before arriving at, you know, this being a congenital cataract? Right. So this is a typical description, you know, we call it as a Medusa head-like appearance, okay? You can see a numerous strands which are rising from the collarette of iris. Of course, you know, iris has actually distorted. You don't see a typical pattern, right? And it is anchored to the anterior capsule, isn't it? Okay. So the one hand, you know, it is attached to the anterior surface, bang in the visual axis, and a numerous iris strands. So symmetrical, almost symmetrical in both eyes. Do you have a revision? Do you want to revise your diagnosis now? And this is a slit wave, although it is not very clear. And I'm taking you to the retro illumination. So what is it? Is it a congenital cataract? It's a persistent pupillary membrane, isn't it? If you carefully look at retro illumination as though it is a PCO, it is almost reminiscent of PCO, right? So it is anchored to the anterior capsule. And I don't know, it lens could be cataractous, you know, that's what, you know. So how do you distinguish? How do you know, you know, the lens is uninvolved? Are there any tests? Would you like to do? So it is a basically, you know, hyperplastic persistent pupillary membrane. You can see, you know, undilated, dilated. Even a refraction was not feasible, undilated. Undilated, you know, you can see the good glow. And unfortunately, in this particular case, we try to do UBM and a OCT to ascertain, is there a component of anterior polar cataract? There are certain cases, yes. So one has to be, you know, these two devices did not give me gray, black and white, because I didn't know even after investigation, is it just a persistent pupillary membrane or a cataract, okay? So anyway, so I went ahead with the intervention. I'll come to the surgical video. So this is other scenario. Again, you have a Medusa head. Instead of anchoring to the lens, it is also attached to the back part of the cornea. Can you see here? It's a corneal opacity, right? So this can come in a variety of shapes. The OCT again shows it is anchoring. So you don't have, you know, in a Peterson anomaly, you see a localized defect in the posterior stroma or excavation. You don't see here either. And rest of the corneal surface is absolutely fine. So this is nothing but a PHPV, right? Anterior segment PHPV. So this is a spectrum. And coming, and you can also, certain times they're very innocuous, wherein you don't have to treat them. And when you do gonio, you have a numerous iris process. So one has to distinguish this particular entity from an axon filariger abnormality. So in a later, wherein you have a numerous irises process which crosses to the Schwalbe's line. So I take you to the surgical video. So as one of you said, I didn't know, apart from a persistent pupillary membrane, is there an anterior capsule is involved? I didn't know then. So I'm inflating the anterior chamber with a dispersive viscoelastic and carefully trying to sever all the hyoid strands. So your care has to be taken to avoid injury to the endothelium or an anterior lens capsule. So the way you peel, you know, Rexis, you know, exactly I was trying to peel. To my surprise, anterior lens capsule was indeed intact. And look at now, obsessively I've been looking here. Did I remove anterior capsule? Can you see here? For a second, if you people can see, there is a pigmentary ring that actually corresponding to the insertion of the pupillary membrane, right? So your anterior capsule indeed intact and the lens is clear. So exactly the similar steps, although during the first eye, I didn't know, I had to take a consent for even a cataract surgery, did calculate IOL and so on, and did the same step in the left eye too. Peeled up this membranes. And again, I was trying to see, can you see? This is a pigmentary insertion. So it is insertion. There is a basically reduplication. It is a persistent pupillary membrane. Can anybody define what is persistent pupillary membrane? Why do we see that? Is it a genetic abnormality? Anyway, so this is a histopath of the Grass images. And postoperatively did a UBM as well as a OCT to show the lens capsule is intact. And you can even postoperatively see right and left eye, you have that pigmentary ring which corresponding to, eventually that pigmentary ring actually faded over the years. So one of the messages I want to give is that not all pupillary membranes actually require a surgical intervention, okay? Unless patient has a visual discomfort, you don't have to touch that, right? And one has to really, you know, monitor them in a long run. So there may be a risk of cataract formation, may have a glaucoma, and these cases have an unrecognized refractive error. It is a part of, you know, the anterior segment PHPV. So therefore, as a rule, they are hyperopic, and there is an axial length maybe much shorter. In the long run, one has to be very vigilant about a glaucoma. So are there any systemic association? So there has been found that, you know, it's basically mesenchymal disorder. They can have something like a detrusor instability. So certain cases may need a urological intervention if at all, if they have a bladder related issues. Are there any questions pertinent to the first case? I'll be happy to answer. So it was, the anterior segment PHPV, otherwise persistent fetal vasculature.
So no questions till now. I think we can continue.
Right. The case scenario two, this was a 7-year-old child who presented with a bilateral corneal opacity. So presenting at very late, you know, obviously, you know, the parents have no access to the, you know, better health care. An examination again, in a child had a bilateral corneal opacification. Okay, so this is a right eye of an image. where you can even see a slit wave, there is a, something called like keratoiridolenticular dyssynesis, meaning the lens as well as an iris failed to separate completely from the cornea. So where do you see such a condition? This is a OCT of the same child. You can actually distinctively make out this is anterior lens capsule. It attached to the back part of the cornea.
Oh.
So do you have any terminology for this?
Peter's anomaly.
Very good. So the failure to separation of the lens or a iris. So you have an iris, only iris is failed to separate is a type 1. If even a lens is, you know, failed to separate from the cornea, we call it as a type 2. Okay, it's very important to distinguish. Again, if you look at left eye, which has a much broader area. So the take it from me, most developmental abnormality where a left eye have a more severe form of a disease, including the primary congenital glaucoma. The reason behind the left side of the human body structure, you know, it undergoes during the embryogenesis, levo rotation. So they tend to, you know, develop, you know, a week or 3 to 5 days prior to the right side of the structure. Because these, most of them, you know, they need a certain cytokines and a transcription factors. Their levels may not be adequate very early on. Whenever you have that mutations or absence, missense of that particular gene, be it a PAX6, be it a PTEX2, be it a FOXC1. So therefore, you know, the left side of the eye tend to be much more severe, you know, when it comes to developmental abnormality compared to the right eye. So and did I again a B scan? Why did I do a B scan here? I wanted to rule out again, you know, any stalk, presence of a posterior stalk. So I wanted to confirm it is a true Peter's anomaly, not a pseudo Peter's, what we actually also seen in a PHPV, right? Again, a UBM of this. I'm sorry, this UBM video is not running. And again, what I did is here, if you can carefully look at, I'm entering directly inside the bag. So what I did is an endo bag, complete bag aspiration. Meaning, you know, because, you know, the lens is anchored to the back part of the cornea, as the axial lens elongate, there is a tractional. So the junules get disrupted. There is a communication. So if I go with the traditional technique of, you know, lens aspiration, so I end up spilling the particulate matter into the vitreous. So that is a very undesirable consequence. You can actually clearly see, you know, the lens is subluxated because if the growing eye, you know, puts a lot of tractional pressure. So mind you, you know, this child is a 7-year-old by the time I've seen. And again, I did an endocapsular extraction. This is the left eye, which is a severe form, the right eye, which has a tiny stalk. I could be able to dissect completely. So one of the key messages I want to give is that, so I fashioned the capsular axis here with a scissor. We should never attempt to separate anterior lens capsule from the back part of the cornea. If you try to do bluntly severe, so you end up creating a desmate avulsion. So that can be a catastrophic complication. If you look at, I'm carefully nudging and trying to remove that attachment from the back part of the cornea. I hope videos are clear for you. Online?
Yes, sir. They are clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So if you can carefully, so it's just a tiny opacity. So what it, you know, I'm trying to highlight is you don't have to do a keratoplasty in this. You know, a simple endo bag lens aspiration with a careful planning. Okay, so look at the right eye has a much better clear cornea. You can actually see the remnant of capsule and child had gained a 20/80 vision in this particular eye. Whereas the left eye, as I said, you know, the type 2 Peter's anomaly, they have a glaucoma risk as high as 80%. And this child in the left eye had a glaucoma as expected, did it, you know, Ahmed glaucoma valve and the cornea decompensated. Considering it is a late presentation, extremely small eye. And of course, you know, there is a competitive inhibition, this left eye, you know, dense amblyopia. I didn't, you know, go for a penetrating keratoplasty, considering it is aphakia, amblyopia, unlikely to have a good outcome here. Not only you end up having a poor anatomical outcome and you don't achieve anything. So at least, you know, we could able to salvage one eye and the child is maintaining a good vision in the other eye with the contact lenses. So the pearl ear avoids severing a communication between the lens and the cornea. If you do, so end up creating a desmoid avulsion and corneal decompensation. So that can be easily avoided. Try preserve bag wherever feasible, although we don't actually end up putting a lens here. So by preserving a bag, at least actually we can maintain that, you know, the biological barrier between anterior and vitreous cavity. So therefore you can avoid in a long run a lot of complications. And in a type 2, keratoplasty has an abysmally poor outcome, not only because of the, you know, the cornea has a vascularity and also fact that, you know, the glaucoma actually compromises in a long run. So that's the biggest independent risk factor. So therefore no keratoplasty, particularly when it comes to type 2, including a keratoprosthesis have been attempted by various groups, and they end up having eventually, you know, it's kind of a stage devisceration. So therefore I don't recommend. And in a certain cases, you can also combine optical iridectomy, or I'll come to the newer procedure called a selective endothelial removal. So again, here I'm stating, you know, in a type 2, you have a glaucoma risk as high as 80%. And if you resort to the conventional approaches, end up having a corneal decompensation. Are there any questions to the...
Sir, there is one question on the persistent pupillary membrane.
Okay.
Is persistent pupillary membrane amblyogenic?
A very great question. So in our case, you know, it wasn't amblyogenic. Fortunately, it had some kind of a pinhole effect. So despite, you know, this child has a eight diopters of undercorrected hyperopia until he presented. So so only explanation I can give is that, you know, it's bilaterally symmetrical disease, and he must have had something called a pinhole effect through the one of the opening. So I think that's only explanation in my case. That's what exactly when I wrote in a JAPOS. So that protected him against the amblyopia. Yes, if it is a unilateral, you are not able to, you know, refract, and it is obscure, your, you know, good fundus evaluation, then that actually merits an intervention.
Thank you, sir.
And unilateral cases also have a very high degree of, you know, refractive error. That has to be again keep in mind. So this was a 4 months old child, and again, it's a unilateral opacity, almost resembling a, you know, the type 2 Peters abnormality. And we did a, you know, UBM, everything. This was, in fact, again, a PHPB. And if you look at, you know, the entire eyeball is distended, had a secondary glaucoma. So the anterior chamber was almost flat, and iris and a lens was anchoring at the visual axis. So I have to use an iris hooks. And here we have to carefully look at, there is something called a Salmon pink patch sign. So that actually indicate, you know, the vascularity from the posterior stalk. So we can also do a UBM and a Doppler imaging to see the, you know, the flow velocity to minimize the postoperative complication like a vitreous bleed. So all I did, you know, again, separated from the back part of the cornea. So I gently polished without disturbing the Descemet's membrane. And over next 3 to 4 weeks, you know, cornea started clearing. And subsequently, I gave a contact lens to this child. You can actually see the red cam images, you know, the stalk. Okay. So once you identify that it's a pink Salmon patch sign, you know, you need to leave behind a frill all around that stalk. If you end up dissecting the stalk, they tend to bleed profusely and end up having a vitreous bleed. So that could be avoided by carefully planning a preoperative imaging. In other words, PHPV can actually present like a pseudopetus, which almost looked like a keratoiridal lenticular dysgenesis, but it wasn't. Because, you know, in a normal petus, you would actually see an excavation on the back part of the cornea. That wasn't the case in this particular case. So the cornea almost cleared. It had a faint haze, and child, you know, improved to 2200 with a contact lens. Can anybody? So we are moving to other entity. What do you see here? So you see an opacity in the visual axis, isn't it? So it's bilateral. Again, a left eye is much severe than the right eye. Okay. So these are the spectrum of Peter's anomaly. At times it can be very innocuous. Look at, the subtle corneal edge and the rest of the pupillary silhouette is well made out. And when you do OCT, you can actually see a posterior excavation. This is a very classic type 1 Peter's anomaly. If you carefully look at, there are iris pigments which defines the perimeter of the opacity. It's a wedge shape and it has extend up to the limbus. It's like a peninsular like opacity. You have a central island which may not have any communication to the periphery. In this particular instance, you have a small band which connect extend up to the periphery. So that's called a typical peninsular. So all that this particular child need early identification and a refractive correction and amblyopia therapy. So when you look at this kind of opacity, what comes to your mind? I was intrigued, for the last 10 to 12 years. There is a defect here. The surrounding corneal endothelium is healthy. Why don't we expect a normal healing response? Why doesn't it heal? So I used to always believe there is some guy here is inhibiting normal endothelial migration. So I repeatedly could able to see this reduplication. You can see here. So you have an excavation, but there is a thin layer. So this is nothing but an anomalous primitive corneal stroma, which is much more evident here. This is perhaps inhibits the normal sliding of healthy endothelium from the peripheral cornea. So that's what, Peter's anomaly, although over the years, the opacity per se actually regresses, but it never completely disappear. And the similar cases, when I took them to the histopath, we could actually see that, some uveal and anomalous, we were trying to, use a special stain to see what exactly this particular layer. This is basically a primitive corneal stroma that's serving as a contact inhibition. Therefore, it inhibits the spontaneous healing of the Peter's anomaly. So these are all sequential images combined, many such images of the patients. Okay. So this was the premise. I came up with a new procedure called a selective endothelial removal. So where my concept was, this was a corneal opacity, you can see occupying the central 4 millimeter bang on the visual axis. Instead of doing a keratoplasty, what I did is, I'm severing the connections because, there are tiny iris strand which extend from colorate and defines the perimeter of this opacity. What I'm doing actually is here, I'm using a bimanual irrigation, trying to, remove that anomalous endothelium and also the primitive stroma without disturbing the Descemet's membrane. So you saw in the OCT also, there is a double layer reduplication. So you can also see this endothelium. So about 1 millimeter all around the opacity, I'm just removing the way we polish the anterior lens capsule. So I'm trying to ascertain I've not done any inadvertent Descemet detachment. So again, these eyes, this child was about barely 6 or 8 weeks old. So they have a very crowded chamber. It's very, very important. They have a huge upthrust to avoid injury both to the lens as well as the uveal tissue. So these are some of the images, OCT images, which you have already seen. So this was a preoperative image. I did the selective endothelial removal. You can actually see the cornea become edematous. And over next 3 to 4 weeks time, the cornea in fact, started becoming much thinner. If you look at pre and a post-op at, 6 weeks time, which was also evident, you can actually see preoperatively, you have an opacity. It is bang on the visual axis. These are the images which taken from the microscope. Okay, this is a right eye inferonasal opacity. Following intervention, you can see I was a little hesitant in the initially. Did I do some damage to this child? If you look at, the density has increased by 3 weeks. At 12 months, look at this. So we were even able to do the refraction also. It's become fainter by 6 weeks and it is almost, it is still there. It persists. When you see a OCT, you can see a defect, but there is a significant improvement in the corneal transparency. So among all the developmental corneal abnormality, Peters anomaly is one of the most common. It accounts for nearly 40% of all transplantations done worldwide. Okay, so if we can eliminate corneal transplantation, that means nearly, you know, the 40% of the congenital corneal abnormality can be taken care without doing a corneal transplantation. So that's a big, actually, bonus to not only to the patient as well as to the parents. Otherwise, once you embark on a pediatric corneal transplantation, it's a lifetime commitment, stringent post-operative follow-up. And mind you, even if we do a keratoplasty, in a best case scenario, it doesn't last beyond, you know, 12 to 15 years. It is only an interim solution considering the life expectancy of this child. You know, let's say, you know, 90 years is the life expectancy when I operate this child. So the corneal transplantation is not a permanent solution. So therefore, you know, this particular new innovative surgical intervention has given away. So far I've completed 34 eyes, and they have a pretty increasing results even in a type 1 and a type 2. Again, this particular case, if you look at 1.5 year. And one other thing, even if the corneal opacity per se doesn't regress in size, okay, from the, you know, so the newborn to the next 3 years, so the corneal horizontal diameter, as you know, it'll expand by 1 to 2 millimeter. So the relatively corneal opacity per se looks smaller as the age advances. So the peripheral cornea is much more clearer. So if you look at this particular right eye of this child over the next 1.5 year, there is a significant resolution of the corneal opacification. And a left eye, which is a much more severe form, so which also. So in this particular case, initially, of course, I had to use a bilateral tropicamide and make sure, you know, we do intermittently patch. So alternative day. And this child has gained a good vision. So this child actually comes from Dubai. Parents, both parents are doctor. They're quite happy with the outcome. So I did explain to them. So this is a new experimental procedure. In case it doesn't work, I might have to consider child for a keratoplasty down the line. So with the informed consent, you know, the parents, this was in fact a second child where bilateral case I did almost, it's about, you know, 7 years ago. And the child doing extremely well without need for a keratoplasty. In conclusion, you know, so the Peters anomaly can come with a diverse spectrum, and it does have a higher risk of, you know, graft rejection, and only nearly third of the grafts survive beyond 3 years, and they have a higher predilection to develop glaucoma and cataract. And they need a lot of re-intervention. And re-intervention, again, have an extremely poor outcome. So something, you know, a non-invasive procedure like a selective endothelial removal can be a very good new surgical strategy in these difficult cases. Are there any questions when it comes to Peters anomaly?
So not for the Peters, but we have 2 questions popped up for the PPM.
Sure.
What are the types of persistent pupillary membrane, and if we have to do pupilloplasty, what is the right age to do?
So the pupillary membrane, you know, as I said, you know, mostly they're innocuous. You don't have to intervene. And this particular, so the pupillary membrane could be iris membranes, which is predominantly an iris, and they can be free floating. And certain times, which I've showed some of the example where, you know, attached or anchored to the back part of the cornea and causing the corneal opacity. In the case example video I've showed, you know, it is attached to the anterior part of the lens. Okay. So there basically, you know, you have a persistent pupillary membrane, which is very innocuous. This is a hyperplastic pupillary membrane. And you have a, something called iris membranes. They tend to produce something called a keratopia. So there is a traction on the, you know, the pupil. So the pupil look eccentric, and those refractive errors have to be taken care. And when to be surgically excised? Only a symptomatic. If the child is showing a manifest, you know, deviation, there is a squint. If you see any gross asymmetry between the refraction, if it precluding, you know, good, you know, decent refraction or a retina view, then that, those are the cases which merits excision. Otherwise, mostly 99% of these membranes, you don't have to do anything surgically.
Okay, sir.
Sir?
Yes?
Can I ask a doubt, ma'am?
Yes.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, regarding the case to the Peter's anomaly, which you told, initially you said like we are not supposed to remove the connection with the lens with the cornea, no, sir?
Correct.
Then how do we remove that direction, that is with the selective endothelial removal?
Very good question. So I think you missed one of the crucial point here. You know, I'll just come back to... So you look at here, this is a type 2 abnormality, right?
So we can't see your screen.
Okay, you can't see my screen? Oh, I'm sorry, I must have exited. Yeah, just give me a second. Right. Can you see you?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So this is a hybrid. This is a different spectrum. You know, this is a type 2 abnormality, keratoiridal lenticular dyssynesthesis. Okay.
Okay.
Here you are not supposed to sever this connection. Okay. Where I did a polishing, you know, I'll just come back to that one. Yeah. Here. So this is a type 1. Meaning you have only either iris pigment or iris strands, and you have a posterior defect. Can you see a posterior defect on OCT?
Okay.
And you can also see an anomalous layer. Can you see an anomalous layer? One
yes,
of the
sir.
Picture? Yes.
Yes.
So we are trying to, you know, polish, you know, you may have a uveal pigment. Look at this histopath of the same child. So you have some anomalous layer. So it may be, it's something, a very primitive layer. That's what Dua, when I had a personal communication with him. So I was just trying to remove that. In fact, you know, we are trying to study electron microscopy. What exactly this is, it a uveal tissue? Because these are all basically neural crest cell migration abnormality. For some unknown reason, this neural crest cells, you know, the first wave, it's supposed to give a corneal endothelium. It stops, you know, some abortive process. We do not know what exactly. It could be one of the, you know, genetic factor, transcription factors. Okay. So variety
so
of condition
can comes under yeah. type 1, sir. So
yeah, this is a type
under,
correct.
One,
this is a type 1 Peter's anomaly. You're right.
Okay, okay.
This is a type 1 Peter's anomaly. So wherein you have only a simple iridocorneal adhesions. You just have to release that attachment and do the polish. I'll again take you to the surgical video. Very nice question, right? So this particular case, so the lens is clear, lens is uninvolved, okay? So where instance where type 2, where I'm directly removing the lens, going inside a bag and aspirating the endocapsular. Look here, lens is clear. I'm just trying to polish the excavated part of the cornea. I'm trying to remove that, you know, whatever residual iris, uveal tissue, and some primitive stroma as per Dr. Dua. So I'm just trying to remove and enable the peripheral corneal endothelium, which have a healing capacity. Although we understand, you know, they don't have a mitotic potential, but they can slide, isn't it?
Yes.
So perhaps, you know, that explains the OCT actually shows the DM gets relayed. So you can also ask me, why didn't you strip the Descemet's membrane? We can strip a Descemet's membrane, but you know, it takes a longer time for a healing. And one of the biggest worry while I attempt to strip the Descemet's membrane, I make a large hole in the central part. Okay. It is a regma. So it is similar to the regmatogenous, you know, retinal detachment. So you have something called a regmatogenous Descemet detachment. Fluid can seep and end up having a large DM detachment. So that was a concern why I didn't actually opt for a Descemetorexis. I did a simple selective endothelial removal and kept that, you know, pre-existing Descemet membrane so that, you know, endothelium can easily slide. Okay, that's what the OCT actually shows. So this was a preoperatively and post-op. You can actually see the reflectivity pattern, everything. So the cornea has become a little more compact. And of course, you know, you have a posterior stromal architectural changes that will persist. So the edema per se actually reduces. Even in this particular case, if you carefully look at on a retro, it is taken from the, you know, the operating microscope, you still have a faint haze, but it is very, very innocuous. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. I have one more question. I think you partly answered it, sir. Optical PKP or DSIRC, which is recommended for Peters anomaly?
Okay. Peters anomaly, you know, so the PK is the way. So if you have an opacity, which is really obscuring the entire visual axis, meaning, you know, it precludes, even after a full dilation, it precludes, you know, decent retinoscopy, and it precludes, you know, the retina view. And if the child has a visual disability, so the way to go is doing a keratoplasty.
Okay, sir.
So apart from, you know, there are certain iris cysts also, we'll just see, you know, how to distinguish in a primary and a secondary. This was a 13-year-old boy with a clear-cut history of, you know, trauma, penetrating trauma. So is supposed to, you know, one of his younger brother has punched him with a ballpoint pen. So that was a kind of history. So they just consulted local doctor. They gave some, you know, possible steroids and antibiotic. So this is what, you know, when he presented. So can anybody define what exactly we see in a slit lamp, digital image? What is it
iris
showing?
Iris inclusion cyst, sir.
Very good. Excellent. You know, yes. So the it is an implantation cyst. What else you see? So I'm giving you a little zoomer version.
There is a scar.
Okay. Very good. There is a window. There is a communication fistula tract. Okay. You're right. So the when I did a UBM, so whatever you see is a pseudocornea or perhaps, you know, the conjunctiva and a tenons covering the wall, the scleral wall as a window. Through that window, probably, you know, epithelium, the limbal epithelium is communicating. So it led to a large cyst. See, you can actually see a fistulous communicating tract and a UBM. Sorry, my UBMs are not playing somehow. And so how do we go about, how do we manage? These are the secondary implantation cyst. Of course, there are congenital primary implantation cyst.
So injecting sclerosing agent and...
Okay, because it's inside the eye. So what kind of a sclerosing agent? So I don't recommend if you have a lesion intraocularly. Okay, let's say if you use a alcohol,
it is and more toxic to the...
Yes, they actually, yes. You know, they breach that, they reaches the anterior chamber. I have seen, you know, people who have injected all kind of a sclerosing agent. They produce, you know, the smoldering inflammation, uveitis. And even I have seen a case where thysis bulbi, somebody had injected, you know, absolute alcohol. So surgical excision is the way to go for all intraocular cysts. So you can actually go through one of my BJO paper recently published. So it is one of the largest series to the date, you know, intraocular implantations is basically. So how do we surgically? Can we go ahead and aspirate? Can we yog it? So nothing seems to work. You know, you have to go very aggressive, go marsupialize these cysts. Unless you remove this fistulous tract, it keep recurring. Can you guess what I did in this particular case? Anybody, any guesses? So my initial pictures had a clue. So this is a clue I'm showing you. There is a window, communicating window. My UBM shows there is a fistulous communicating tract. By simply removing iris cyst, you can't prevent the recurrence, right? Let's see surgically what I did. So I learned this technique from Dr. Santosh Honawar. You know, he described me, told me once, you know, how do I go about? So I'm just going with the aspiration needle. It'll not only give me, you know, the specimen for the cytology, and it also, you know, collapsing my cyst, isn't it? My dissection would be much simpler and easier. So you have a scleral defect, that window. I did a patch graft. Look at this, is about, you know, 4 millimeter. I've used a skin punch graft. Can you see? So the entire cyst is, you know, anchored to that. And I've defined a similar around 4.5 millimeter graft, securing. Let's see post-operative. Let's see, look at this histopath. So you have a communicating fistula tract, and you have a goblet cells, everything suggestive of their conjunctival origin. They're indeed, you know, implantation cysts. So is the cytology. You can see the numerous goblet cells. And he has completed a 3 years now. You can also see, you know, that I've done a large sector iridectomy. This is a graft. And I spared deliberately the pupil because he's a young boy. So other eye has a 20/20 vision. So we didn't want any glare, you know, visual disability, particularly night vision. And this particular child had a good vision, no recurrences even after he has just completed, I think, 6 years. Okay. So the no recurrences of the iris cyst. So this is how we can actually, so you can, I reserve a sclerosing agent only for an extra ocular cyst. So one has to really ensure to perform preoperatively UBM, ensure that they don't have any communicating fistula tract. Otherwise, each of these sclerosing agent can actually seep in. They not only, you know, produce a corneal decompensation cataract, and a worst case scenario, they can also produce the ciliary shutdown and hypotony, and they can have an extremely poor anatomical outcome. So one of the keys, a very meticulous examination combined with a good history, and UBM actually helps you, not only helps you clinching the diagnosis, and it also helps you to strategize your surgical intervention. Whether, you know, when if I had gone for a simple excision, this child would have had a multiple recurrences. So also look at, you know, when you spill that intracystic content into anterior chamber, it produces the inflammation, uveitis, which in turn, you know, produces a cataract, secondary glaucoma, and so on. Okay. So I just completed, you know, removed that entire fistulous tract. That's one of the safest way to, you know, minimize recurrences. Otherwise, these are very, very recalcitrant. There is a one particular child I have to do, you know, 4 times cyst excision. So then a 4th time, I believe again, I planned a, you know, large diameter corneal transplantation. So that gave a immunity against the recurrences. Are there any questions? Also make sure, you know, you go for histopath to confirm what you are removed is a benign lesion.
So there is one question.
Go ahead, please.
What is the source of graft taken in the cyst to cover the fistula tract?
Oh, extremely good question. I didn't waste the tissue here. You know, I use a peripheral rim. Okay. That's very nice. Good observation. Whoever has asked this particular question. Yeah, you can use a peripheral rim. That's what, you know, you can see a sclera also I've punched. Can you see the sclera? Yeah.
Yes.
So I did not use a new tissue. It is one of the, you know, the peripheral rim which are taken. Okay. So you can actually, you know, nicely fashion, you know, part of the sclera. It's kind of a D-shaped, you know, graft. So you don't have to actually use a central cornea, because even when you do a peripheral thing, you know, the peripheral cornea is much thicker, right? You need to have a proportionately very thick donor. You can't afford to use a central cornea, which is 500 and 520. So you may have a step. And again, you know, uveal tissue can actually come and form a pass formation, everything, right?
Yes, sir. So there is one more question. Good. What is the maximum of inclusion cyst without a fistula?
Okay, management. So as a rule, there must have been a perilimbal wound to, in order to get a cyst. You know, I have a different presentation for that. So when you look at the mechanism, So see, the limbal epithelium, which has a proliferating capacity, right? So when they actually, you know, implanted onto the uveal tissue has a highly vascular tissue, an anterior chamber has an arcade, and it is a immune compromised kind, you know, it's like an immune privileged structure. So these cells get such an extremely good nourishment wherever they get implanted, they keep growing. So at times, you know, you may have a transparent, thin, you know, the lining, you know, which grows on, and sometimes even it abutting the cornea and uveal surface. People have described a variety of ways, simple aspiration, injecting variety of simple, you know, ethyl alcohol to all kind of a sclerosing agent. And people have even, you know, applied a cryo cyclophotocoagulation. I believe, you know, when you have a, this may work in a primary cyst, they are much more benign. They actually follow a certain pattern of the progression, you know, the beyond puberty is, you know, they tend to involute. Whereas, you know, the secondary cyst, particularly acquired implantation cysts, they are very recalcitrant. So one of the ways is, which I believe, you know, a complete cyst marbulization. If you don't see a communicating wound, you do a complete cyst marsupialization, meaning, you know, all walls of the cyst have to be removed.
Thank you, sir. I think we can continue.
So the case scenario, so I'm not giving you any history here. It is very, very evident. So what are we seeing here? Close-up picture.
Sclerocornea, sir.
Ramya, you can carefully look at now. I know, you know, the, you know, you have a ill-defined limbus. There is some reticular blood vessels, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So what about this? There is a communication. I can pick up this particular lesion which has an attachment here.
Dermoid, limbal dermoid.
Yes, exactly. Perfect. So what do you call, what kind of dermoid it is? What kind of dermoid? Oh, yes. So the dermal lipoma is encased within the sheets of conjunctiva antennans, right? Here, this is called a reticular flat dermoid. Okay, so it is extension of the dermal lipoma. So you would see a, you know, the classic limbal dermoid you must have seen, right? Wherein, you know, you have a skin-like, buff-colored, elevated lesion, okay, which has ear appendages, ear follicles, so on. Here you can actually see a double dermoid. So there is an entity called a Tessier syndrome, wherein you see a double dermoid. This is almost, you know, hallmark of Tessier syndrome, wherein you have a double dermoid. You have a reticular flat dermoid with, you know, you have, if you trace it, you have a large dermal lipoma. The one of the reason why you have this reticular, you know, the blood vessels extending onto the cornea is that you don't have a limbal palisade here. Okay. So, and the rest, you know, you have about 7 to 8 clock hours, you know, limbus is intact. And these are the cases we should not be touching. So once you remove them, so they tend to have a pseudo-pterygium kind of a formation, conjunctivalization, okay? So the dermoid can be defined as an epibulbar, epi above the bulbus, that is a, you know, globe. So it can be, this is a limbal, classic limbal dermoid. Can anybody tell me why do we get limbal dermoid, this kind of a limbal dermoid, invariably? What is the commonest location 99% of the time?
Limbus.
Are you, limbus, where is it? It is straddling at limbus. Which area? Is it nasal, temporal, superior?
Inferotemporal.
Extremely good answer. Why do you get inferotemporal? So where do we get, you know, what is this? This is a basically choriostoma, right? Normal,
yes,
tissue in an abnormal location. Why do we have, where do we get? Which are those locations which have a biological predilection to have a dermoid? What are those locations? So the entire cornea is derived from, cornea and sclera is derived from ectoderm, right? Only this part of the sclera is derived from the mesoderm. So it is a junction between ectoderm and a mesoderm. That's where, you know, these tissues get trapped and you have a dermoid. Okay, this is a classic, you know, limbal dermoid. This is a flat reticular dermoid. You also have a something called osseous cartilaginous, right? So yes. this is again a classic, you know, double dermoid. You can actually see a flat reticular. This was a case of a, again, Tessier syndrome, not golden hour. Golden hour where you see a limbal dermoid. So what is it? Is it a dermoid? Somebody labeled me from Delhi this case and sent to me for a dermoid. Is it a dermoid? So it almost looked like a dermoid, right? We tempted to call this, label this as a dermoid. Isn't it? So can anybody guess what it is? So it's a keratectasia. So because, you know, it is exposed, the cornea has been completely keratinized. This is an eyeball basically. So exposed eyeball, you can call it as a staphyloma, keratectasia. Only difference between staphyloma and keratectasia. So along with ectasia, you have a uveal tissue, that's a staphyloma. If you have only a cornea, which is like a ballooned out, so that's called a keratectasia. So this again, a congenital abnormality. So this child here is extreme microphthalmia, keratectasia, and child, you know, able to appreciate a light in this particular case. So I did not dare to operate. I told them, you know, whatever vision child has, the light perception, she may lose. Because, you know, keratinization is one of the poorest prognostic marker for a corneal, you know, grafting. So this is a typical golden hour syndrome. So golden hour syndrome is also called, you have all clinical
oculo-auriculo-vertebral syndrome. Auriculo-vertebral.
Dysplasia, you can also call dysplasia. So you have a midfacial excavation, you have a jawbone which is retracted, okay? Low set ears. They have, a, you know, if you look at, you know, his neck is so short, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So this particular child had a right eye, you know, the surgery was done at SN. They've done a simple excision and we did a subsequent large graft and that resulted in a good outcome. Okay. So how do we distinguish? So what are these lesions? Are they dermoid?
Sir, corneal keloids.
Good. Very nice. So you can actually see this is a raised, elevated, gelatinous, shiny lesions bang on the visual axis. Okay. So this is the two variants. So this is also, we can define as a keloid or even histopathological diagnosis is a fibrous pannus. In both instances, apart from this main lesion, you can see a numerous lesions, right? As the time progresses, these tiny lesions coalesce to form a, this is an evolution, you know. So we have a new paper which submitted wherein, you know, one of the pathologists from US Chicago has helped me to, you know, classify this dermoid. We have so far 27 cases. So this is called as an immature type 1 dermoid, I mean type 1 keloid, wherein you don't have a much vascularity. It is primarily, you know, the abnormal keratocyte response to any insult. It may be intrauterine or following postnatally, there may be some injuries or medicines can actually trigger this keloid-like response. So this is a type 2, which is a very aggressive and progressive, it progresses. This may remain stationary. And can you enumerate any syndromes which are associated with the keloid? Can anybody?
No syndrome? Mm-hmm.
Yes, there are a variety of syndromes which are associated, which Lope have eye predilection for a keloid. This is again a keloid. This is also a keloid. It's not a dermoid. So how do we histopathologically? So this one, you know, although, you know, I initially made a, you know, reticular flat dermoid, but the location was supero-nasal. I was not convinced and went to, you know, Geeta madam and asked for a particularly in a dermoid, you actually see a skin appendages, right? Sebaceous gland, hair follicles, and so on. So she didn't find anything here. So that's what we labeled it as a type 2 keloid. So you have a something called a Rubinstein-Thiber. Have you heard about Rubinstein-Thiber? So this is a very classic Rubinstein-Thiber syndrome. They have a IU predilection for developing a keloid. So this is a type 2 keloid, as I said, there are vascular component and it tend to progress. Okay. And this particular instance, it was a full thickness. And what was revealing in this particular case report is that when we carefully look at the entire trabecular meshwork, Schlemm's canal were absent, because I did a very large graft encompassing this entire defect, because I was always worried about, this keloid tend to recur. So when we carefully look at that specimen, which we had refined, so where we can actually see abruptly the Schlemm's canal trabecular meshwork ceases to exist. So when I, probed into literature, in fact, this particular gene, which helps in anterior segment maturation and development of the trabecular meshwork. In fact, these cases have nearly 70 to 80% risk of developing an intractable glaucoma. So this is also called, what is the alternative name for this syndrome? Rubinstein-Theiber. So this is about, 3 or 4 day old baby. Look at the scalp here. That is one of the pathognomonic feature of a Rubinstein-Theiber, okay? They have such a dense air. So it is also called, the broad, thumb, great toe syndrome, okay? Rubinstein and Theiber, there are two different people. One geneticist, one is a pediatrician. So they both had a similar syndrome. And one of the third person, that ophthalmologist, actually, bridged them, both of them. That's how, this became a Rubinstein-Theiber. That's a sweet story behind this particular syndrome. So now we'll come back to how did I manage that particular dermoid. If you look at this, is a large dermoid straddling the limbus. I think I have a 3 minutes. After this video, we will stop. I think I have a 400 slides and many number of surgical interesting videos. So simple excision doesn't actually help. Okay. So since, if I do a simple patch graft, I will be again, encompassing the visual axis. Therefore, I planned a large eccentric dermoid excision and a lamellar keratoplasty. Okay. This, I've done everything manually. So why didn't I attempt a big bubble here? Can anybody? It's a very interesting question. So why didn't I attempt a big bubble here? You saw the dissection, right? I was doing a layer by layer dissection. Anybody can tell? I'm doing a layer by layer. No answers? So where does your Descemet's membrane terminate? So if you look at, if this is an eccentric trepanation, I've gone much beyond the limbus, isn't it? So the Descemet's membrane terminates here. If I attempt a big bubble, so I end up disrupting the Descemet's membrane. So this particular child postoperatively did very well. So what is this? So this is again other central corneal dermoid. So I initially thought myxoma, you must have heard about, right? So there is something called a Carnegie complex, atrial myxoma, and embolic disorder. So I was initially worried about that, and it turned out to be central corneal dermoid. So what I wanted to highlight is that here, so you can also do hydrodelamination, viscodelamination. Right, you can see this is a technique called hydrodelamination. You don't have to go and do a big bubble every time. Right, can you see that one? So the big hydro bubble. So these are again keloid, simple excision, dermoid. So that's the histopath of that, okay? So we call it as a complex choriostoma. Why do we call, the histopath? Can you see histopath of this? What do you see here? What do you see here? Anybody? These are acini, these are the salivary gland, not a lacrimal gland, for example, exocrine glands. You have a cartilage here, okay? You have a, the fatty tissue, and had a muscle also. So histopathologically, you have all the derivatives, right? You have a muscle, cartilage, and exocrine gland. So that actually constitute the complex choriostoma, right? So this particular child did extremely well postoperatively. So what I did, a paired-eye comparison, simple excision versus doing a simple DALC, okay? Nowadays, I use the pre-cap of the DSEC button. So one of the reasons how it prevents normal re-epithelialization or a conjunctivalization is that it will provide some niche for the corneal epithelium so that, you know, the conjunctiva doesn't come onto the cornea. As in this particular simple excision with EMG, so they're likely to have a poor cosmesis, poor outcome. Okay. Again, this is a form of a keloid. Again, a keloid have extremely good outcome. So it's a 9, I think. I believe we'll stop here. I will be happy to take questions.
Sir, it would be great if you can continue for next 15 minutes or so and cover few topics as requested by the postgraduates.
Sure.
Frequently asked in the exam about the first is the congenital corneal opacities, next is microcornea, and the third one megalocornea. You can take next 15-20 minutes and if you can cover.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
So these are all really big topics. Yeah, so I'll go to that particular presentation. So can anybody, what is this particular child?
Hurler syndrome.
Yeah, extremely good. So he is, I'll give you something, you know, his IQ was really good. Hurler syndrome, they have a cognitive impairment, isn't it? So this particular child was studying Hunter, so only mucopolysaccharidosis, which will never involve cornea, is a Hunter's. So in my MCQs, I used to remember Hunter's need a clear cornea. Okay. Right. So yeah, the type 1 Hurlers, you know, type 1 MPS is called Hurlers, She's, and She's Hurlers. Okay. Variant, right? And you also have something called a Martox Lamy, right? So this particular child is a type 6 Martox Lamy. Again, I did a DALK here. So you have to either do a manual DALK or you can even visco-assisted DALK. The reason is that, you know, this glycosaminoglycan, so they occupy all the collagen spaces within the cornea, okay? They do not let the air to percolate. So therefore, you know, we came up with this idea, started using hydro, visco delamination, or even a manual technique. And these cases are very rewarding. And I have so far 23 children where I've done a DALK in these cases. And we know it is a life-limiting disease. We can actually change their life. Are there any questions in terms of, you know, I skipped most of the slides because, you know, this is again, you know, nearly 1 hour class. So there are basically, you know, 9 types of mucopolysaccharidosis. The type 2 Hunters is the one which doesn't involve the cornea. Type 1, that is a Hurlers and a She's variant where may have a normal intellect, unlike Hurlers. Hurlers, you know, they don't survive beyond the first decade. And the type 4, which I have, you know, 90% of the cases, Martox Lamy, where, you know, they can reasonably have a up to fourth decade they survive. One of the most common, you know, cause of death here is a restrictive lung pathology. They can have hypostatic pneumonia and cardiac issues. So those are the reasons. And we have to be extremely cautious here. Imaging is one of the important, you know, strategy before, you know, we have to, may have to do a VEP. Because, you know, eventually they end up having optic atrophy, okay? Because, you know, this glycosaminoglycans actually build up in the canal, so they produce a compressive optic neuropathy. So therefore, you know, the imaging is one of the ways we can actually prognosticate. I have had cases where, you know, the both DALKs, the cornea was good and child, you know, maintained a good vision for a couple of years and disease was worsening. And eventually, you know, so the retina and optic nerve involvement. So the baby had a kind of a tunnel vision. Eventually, you know, we lost that child because of the respiratory issues. And most of these cases, even, you know, intubation is nearly impossible because the entire nasopharynx, you know, it's so much constricted because of the glycosaminoglycan. Anesthetist actually, you know, it's a nightmare for any anesthetist. So I'll take you to the cloudy cornea. You can see the different shades of the gray here. So this is a very classic shade. And we do, you know, endothelial keratoplasty in these cases. I'll simultaneously run, you know, interest of the time. So endothelial keratoplasty, as we know, has a several distinct advantages. So here something, you know, you can see a double ring sign. Anybody can see? What is this double ring sign? Can you make out some double ring, golden ring? You know, when you do an hydrodissection, you see a double ring, right? Golden ring. You can actually see one is the internal ring, one is the outer ring. So the internal ring abutting the, it is a little smaller comparatively abutting the posterior stroma. So when you punch, you know, the from the endothelial side, it is curved, right? So since it is curved, so you end up punching the endothelial side much bigger than the stromal side, right? So that actually gave rise to this configuration. So the double ring sign is one of the surest way to know your lenticular orientation. Very non-invasive way. So this is some of the densitometry I have done, parpometry. So this particular child, look at it. This is a child, bilateral child, done a DSEC with a simple superficial keratectomy. That means, you know, the dense degenerative pannus has been atraumatically removed. Did apply amitomycin. In a 6 months, you see a significant clearing of the cornea. So we end up avoiding keratoplasty, conventional keratoplasty, because conventional keratoplasty, you have a suture-related issues. Children are very prone for infection, higher rejection rate, and they don't provide that good tectonic stability unlike a DSEC. And in a DSEC, you know, this case had a less than 1.5 diopter of astigmatism. We can't even assume such kind of a low level of astigmatism after a keratoplasty. Therefore, you know, we are slowly moving on to the selective lamellar procedure. They have a huge advantage. If you compare, you know, this is a pristine clarity following a penetrating keratoplasty. I agree, some of these cases is a huge trade-off because, you know, their transparency is not as good as the last. But some of the cases, if we do intervention early on, they do reach very, very close to the PK. There is a little trade-off, but it has a, certainly has a huge advantages. So what I did is, you know, based on little over 200 cases of CHED, and if you look at preoperatively, none of them we could actually do a refraction. Okay, look at that vision. So average vision, you know, in a logmar 1.56, it's only an ambulatory vision. And a pachymetry is almost close to 1,000 micron, and densitometry is nearly 40. By 3 months, you can see all of them we could refract. By 1 year, you know, you can see astigmatism, mean astigmatism, you know, it's less than, you know, 2 diopter following a corneal transplantation. That's not heard of. And within 3 months, the pachymetry regresses by 50%. Okay. So is the hyperopia. If you can see, look at, you know, the gradually the spherical power is reducing. So this is reducing because the cornea, host cornea, is getting thinner and thinner. Okay. So that explains why hyperopia reduces over the time. So therefore, you know, what our study actually showed, so DSEC can be a better alternative for the, rather than a keratoplasty in some of these cases. So in this part of the world, you know, the CHED is a much more prevalent. The reason is a parental consanguinity. So I'll stop here, this cloudy cornea thing. And so we'll discuss about megalocornea. So the megalocornea has a certain criteria. So you just have to rule megalocornea in an infant. If somebody has a more than 12 millimeter is a horizontal white diameter, any age more than 13 millimeter. So no doubt, you know, they have a deep chamber and their intraocular pressure is normal. When you measure their, you know, axial length, you know, so they may not have the disproportionate, you know, axial elongation. So, they don't have any, their limbus is well-defined. They don't have a scleral thinning. So these are the strict criteria to label somebody as a simple isolated megalocornea, okay? And you also have to rule out they are not having any peripheral Descemet scars, okay? So that indicative of a PCG. PCG can also produce a megalocornea, right? So we just have to rule out some of the site-threatening conditions before labeling somebody as a simple megalocornea. There is also something called anterior megaloophthalmos. Have you heard about relative anterior megaloophthalmos? Anybody? So how do we distinguish? Are we dealing with relative anterior megaloophthalmos or a simple megalocornea? So in a relative anterior megaloophthalmos, it's a basically developmental abnormality where the scleral ring or a limbal ring which expands disproportionately, okay? And their anterior to vitreous chamber length is disproportionately anterior is much bigger. When you measure overall, you know, their axial length may be a normal around 23 to 25. But if you look at, you know, the proportion between anterior to posterior segment is altered. Why it's very important? Because, you know, this corneal diameter may be sometimes 14 or a 15 millimeter. If you don't recognize, invariably they have a zonular dehiscence. So if we end up, you know, taking these cases for a simple phaco emulsification, you know, it can be a nightmare on table. You will never recognize any phacodonosis. You will never see anything. So once you start operating them, so that's how, you know, it's very, very important to distinguish relative anterior megaloophthalmos from a simple megalocornea. And the other thing which you had is a congenital corneal opacity. So that's, you know, we normally used to remember stumped. So that doesn't have any relevance in the era wherein we have a UBM and a OCT, okay? So as I said, one of the most common is again a Peters, then the sclerocornea, then you have axonal rigor, you have a primary congenital aphakia, and the entire complex of anterior segment cleavage syndrome, okay? These are primarily, so these are all called a primary congenital corneal abnormality, meaning, you know, the pathology lies within the cornea, including the dermoid. They all have a problem within the cornea. Whereas a secondary, it could be because of secondary to the separation of the iris, lens, that can give a secondary corneal opacities, including a PHPV, all that which I showed is a secondary. So that's basically Ken Nischel has proposed very beautiful classification. This is basically a surgical classification for a prognostication. Those which are primarily confined to the cornea origin of congenital corneal opacity, there may be iris or a lens is contributing. And the third variant is, you know, you have a trauma, infection, iatrogenic, so on.
Sir, is there one question here?
Yeah, sure.
Does the megalocornea won't have any zonular dehiscence? And
yeah, isolated simple megalocornea, yes. So you can confirm that only, you know, after, you know, doing a complete biometric. Okay? You have to calculate, you know, their anterior chamber depth, the lens thickness, and particularly vitreous chamber. And you also have to look at, you know, the parents and do anybody in the family have that, okay? Whereas the relative anterior megaloophthalmos is a familial abnormality. Again, it's a basically gene. So if you invariably examine, you know, the pedigree, one of the, you know, the parent or a sibling, one of the family member may have that. It's a very, very important to distinguish other conditions. So the simple isolated megalocornea is a very benign condition which doesn't need any intervention except, you know, the pair of spectacles.
And in anterior megaloophthalmos, sir, how will we know that it is going to go into zonular dehiscence, or how do we suspect it?
The reason is, you know, this if you look at, you know, when you measure Y to Y diameter, so it may be 13 or 15 millimeter. So I think maybe 10 or 12 years ago, you know, I operated such a case, a 40-year-old man who had a posterior subcapsular cataract. And so I realized I did a rexis with a great difficulty and he hardly had any nucleus. So started aspirating, you know, the, you know, bag started coming out. So then with a great difficulty, put a CTR, everything. Then I dilated postoperatively since I had not seen myself this particular case. Then his brother also had a similar future. And when I checked, you know, his IVOL power was on a little plus side. Okay. So that made me think about, you know, something called a relative anterior megaloptalmos. It's a familial thing. And because, you know, your cornea, everything, you know, distends, so that actually compromises the geonules.
Okay. Sir, just few words on microcornea also, please.
Yeah, microcornea, again, less than 9 millimeter. So we can have an isolated microcornea, which could be, you know, associated with the sclerocornea. It could be associated with the cornea plana. It could be associated with the simple congenital primary apicia. And there are conditions wherein you have it's just simple microcornea, meaning, you know, their palisades are normal. The otherwise, you know, the corneal size, contour, curvature, transparency, thickness, everything is normal except the size. So there are a variety of syndromes, you know, comes, you know, right from Froehn syndrome to Hiller-Stipman syndrome. There are so the numerous cases. So wherein, you know, they may not have any other associations.
So for the exam point of view, sir, how do we define microcornea?
Microcornea less than 9 millimeters. The horizontal corneal diameter, any age less than 9 millimeter, you can, you know, call it as a microcornea. See, microcornea, you can also see even in a rubella, right? Congenital rubella. Okay, there are a variety of associated syndromes. Sorry, I'm not able to recollect. There are at least, you know, there are 25 syndromes which are known to associated with the microcornea, including your coloboma. So there are many things. So there are actually diagnostic criteria. It's a while ago which I read and made a presentation on this. So before labeling somebody has a isolated microcornea, you have to rule out all these possibilities, including, you know, so the coloboma. So meaning, you know, there can be a potentially very sight-threatening, you know, conditions.
Thank you so much, sir. That's all with the questions. And that's really an interesting presentation with a lot more interesting videos. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Murali, for a wonderful talk. Very, very illustrative. Nice videos, wonderful pictures. Thank you so much. Very confident.
Thank you, sir. We always look after you, sir. And I'm your Ekalavya. And I've never expressed in any platform. So I'm really, sir, right from my, you know, postgraduate days. So you've been, you know, big, big influence on my life.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'm really honored.
Thank you. So we'll have you back again, Murali, on some other topic in cornea that you may be interested in.
Sir, I think I'll take you through the developmental abnormality. I could not. The reason is,
right,
you know, your student wanted something very interactive. So I have a very nice presentation, Sana, you know, the development right from embryology. I'll take them through all kind of a congenital and anterior segment abnormality, including some of our co-managed case. I don't know, you remember some of the partial cryptophthalmos,
mm-hmm,
which you operated. They are doing, some of the cases are fabulous. One child is a 14-year-old, which you did Cutler beard, is really doing fabulous.
Great.
Thank you, sir.
We'll have you back then at the end of the cornea cycle, maybe.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Sure. It's always a pleasure, sir.
Thank you so much. And next week, we have next Wednesday, we have Dr. Prashant Garg speaking on bacterial keratitis. So we have a trilogy on keratitis, bacterial, fungal, and viral. Each will be covered for 1 hour duration. So September 2, Wednesday, please join for Dr. Prashant Garg on bacterial keratitis. Good night.